Welcome to the 46th Annual Prix de West Invitational Art Exhibit and Sale. Here to begin today's seminar is the Curator of Ethnology for the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, Dr. Eric Singleton.
Good morning. Thank you. Good morning and thank you for joining us for our second day of seminars. I'd like to first thank our sponsors shown on the screen behind me. The museum is able to provide quality education and experiences because of these organizations and individuals. We have another outstanding presentation this morning, followed by the highly anticipated Robert Lockheed Memorial Award and the Prix de West Purchase Award winner announcements at noon. We invite you to stay with us for the presentation of these awards directly following our lunch break. Now we begin our seminar with the 2017 Prix de West Purchase Award winner. Born and raised in Sheridan, Wyoming, the American West is an integral part of him. He is drawn to the quieter side of life. Over time, he has developed a discipline of patiently observing and studying the often unnoticed rhythms and subtleties of his surroundings. In his paintings, he strives to build layers and textures with pigment to create the abstraction and nuanced depth he feels in nature and the world around him. In the words of London writer and art critic John Russell Taylor, what is perhaps Lawson's greatest single gift is his ability to capture nature and quality of light, whether he's evoking the relaxing warmth of a lazy summer afternoon on the farm or the chill of a snowy field in winter. The distinctive light is always intensely felt and precisely observed. Tim is a master of the timeless moment. Here to present Realism versus Abstraction, please welcome Tim Lawson.
Thank everybody. I want to thank you for coming out. I want to particularly thank the National Cowboy Hall and Western Heritage Museum for giving us this venue and for giving us this wonderful exhibition space and this show, the Prix de West. I'd also like to thank them for giving me a week of sleepless nights, wondering what I'm going to talk about here. Anybody who knows me, knows that I would not be up here right now without my lovely wife, Dory. And I'd like to thank her for being by my side and giving me great advice. The type of advice I get is just what she gave me 45 seconds ago. She saw me with the mic on. She said, oh, we're having an exercise class this morning? So I thought since it's early in the morning, we can start out that way. Everybody stand up a little bit. We can get going. When Megan asked me yesterday what my talk is about, I thought, well, maybe give her abstraction versus representational or realism. But what I hope to do today is not separate the two, but to point out how close they are, that the two is. And I think sometimes we start to put labels on things, and if we recognize it, we call it representational. And if we can't recognize it, then it's abstract and it's foreign to us. I believe that all good representation painting has abstraction in it. And I think to start, the best way to do it is to kind of warm up a little bit. Representational or abstraction? I think we'd all agree that this is a representational painting. An abstraction painting. Usually, you're in one camp or the other. But the same person did both of these paintings. Gerhard Richter, who I find fascinating, can also paint almost photorealism. And the scope that he's able to convey is fascinating. I love looking at his work. And when you see a piece like this, it's, for me, it's mesmerizing to look at. The textures, the quality of the paint, the surface of the paint. We go again, a representational piece. There's a big movement of plein air painting, which is nothing more than the French word meaning open air, where you take your gear outside. This was done by the great Spanish painter Antonio Lopez Garcia, titled Gran Via. And he painted this entire painting plein air. It took him 7 years to do it, and it was about a half an hour to 35, 40 minute drive, depending on Madrid's traffic. It's the main street in Madrid called Gran Via. I had the opportunity 5 years ago to go over and meet Mr. Garcia, and I asked him about this painting. I said, is there anything you would wish you had done differently? And he had a big retrospective show at the Baron Thyssen Museum, and he said they had a big poster of it, and it was about 6 feet, 7 feet. And he said, when I saw the poster, I wish I had done it bigger. He was limited in size because he painted right in that striped area where the two roads meet. And he kind of attached, there's a telephone pole there. But he told an interesting story that he had a client that wanted to buy it before it was finished. And he wanted to sell the painting, so he was gonna work from photographs with it. And he said, I spent just about an hour or so, and I knew that I'd ruin the painting if I didn't finish it on plein air. And so he called the collector and said, you're gonna have to wait until the next season. Another story, and I said, well, how do you start a painting like that? Where do you begin? And he said, oh, all right, kind of right where everything converges, and then he builds out. And he'd set up there, he'd drive, as long as the light was consistent, he would go every day. And after 3 years, he had just pulled out a little part of it. And a woman that had walked by every day commuting in the street finally tapped him on the shoulder, looked over and said, paint something else. Fortunately for us, he didn't. To see this painting live is just, it takes your breath away. Again, abstraction, right? This is a Richard Diebenkorn painting that he did in 1951. The title of it's Albuquerque. And though we can't, or I can't, see anything representational in this, this painting to me has a feeling of the American Southwest as much as any painting I've ever seen. The color scheme, the composition, the playment of it. So Diebenkorn is one of those artists that I think crosses over and skirts the, you're not quite sure if he's abstract or representational. His Ocean Park series kind of skirt that line right down the middle where you're not sure. You can look at some of them and you think, oh yeah, that's a cityscape. And then you look at them the next day or the next time and they're total abstraction. Sometimes you get a piece that you're not quite sure. This has some representational elements in it, but it also could be easily looked at as total abstraction. This was done by the Russian painter Nikolai Timkov. And then I love the surface of this painting. Again, the artist has a tool, and you know, my week of sleepless nights, I wasn't sure how I was going to address this. It's such a privilege for me to be in this exhibition with so many of my, and have the great pleasure of calling so many of the other artists in the exhibition friends and close friends. There's nothing I'm going to say up here today that they don't know, and many of them know far more than I do. But I hope that I can point out through some of the examples of work that excite me and inspire me, and also to the collectors, that when you're looking at representational work, there's more to it. There's so much more of what we do than just going out and rendering what's in front of you. The countless, the infinite decisions that are made in each piece. So I thought I would start by, we have another abstraction piece here. Or is it really abstraction where there's non-representation? Because this is nothing more than a close-up of Nikolai Feshin's Lady in Pink that hangs in the Fry Museum. And if you look right where her legs are bent, that's where this close-up comes from. So I personally love paintings where you're not quite sure what you're looking at. Across the room, they look very representational. And as you start to approach them, things just start to dissolve. And you're like, wait a minute, that was just a leg 5 feet back there. And now I walk up and it's just a bunch of squiggly paint. But look at the wonderful activity and the energy in that piece. So to kind of start, I guess we have to come up with with definitions. So I found a definition that says abstract art uses a visual language of shape, form, color, line to create a composition that may or may not exist with a degree of independence from reference of the visual world. I think that covers pretty much, but if we eliminate just a couple words from that, if we take out abstraction and we put in may or does, we could read it and it will apply to just about every painting in the exhibition here and any painting that follows representation. If we just say art is a visual language that uses form, color, line to form a composition that is, at least for me, all of my paintings are inspired by the natural world. I try to get abstraction in it, but I've never had a creative idea on my own. But I get my ideas, my inspiration from things I see in nature. So all of my work is based on observations in nature. And I never know when that's going to happen. With the five children that Dory and I have, I found over the years that it happens a lot of times at the most inconvenient time. I try to leave. We're back in Sheridan, Wyoming, and we have a wonderful opportunity to live 15 miles outside of town on a horse ranch. And I try to get the kids ready, and we bring them in my studio. I have a fabulous studio in a building built in 1916. You would never expect it to be in Sheridan, Wyoming, or the West. It looks more like a studio that you'd find in Paris or London. There's a wonderful window that goes up vertical, and then the top part is sloped, like you see in the old turn-of-the-century studios in Europe. So, you know, it seems like every day that we're running 5 or 10 minutes late and I don't have time to stop is when I see something that I really want to paint. I'm running 10 minutes late for dinner or something and we're on our way, that's when you see it. I really don't go out looking for a painting. I spend a lot of time outside just observing. I try to stay open, both mentally. I don't go out with preconceived ideas. And so, I wait for ideas or that inspiration to come to me. So if we develop a little that idea of trying to put a definition on art, Delacroix said that a painting is nothing but a bridge between the soul of the artist and the spectator. And for me, it's those last couple words that is the important part, and the spectator. I spend a lot of time kind of giving myself hypothetical questions. And what is art? What's the difference between a painting and a piece of artwork? And you know, if we take a great master's work, Vermeer or Rembrandt or Van Gogh or Raphael's Cardinal in Red, and we put it in a closet, is it still a great masterpiece? Or does it just become paint on canvas or on linen? I like to think that once it goes in the closet, once it goes to the vault, it just becomes a painting. It's not until somebody takes it out next week, next year, next century, that it becomes a work of art again. And I liken that to, if any of you like to go to the concert, to either musical or theater, what's the difference between the final dress rehearsal and opening night? One thing, the audience. The final dress rehearsal, the cast is not learning lines anymore. They've memorized those long ago. They know their steps. If it's a musical concert, they know their piece of music inside and out. They can play it blindfolded, they can play it anywhere. But there is a substantial difference, in my opinion, between opening night and the final dress rehearsal. And the one thing that separates that is the audience. So I love this quote by Delacroix because it takes two people. It takes the artist and the viewer. There has to be something. So by that definition, it's not what hangs on the wall, or it's not the printed words in a book. It's not the notes of music. And I always think of that adage of the piano, the music teacher saying, well, I hear you're playing all the notes correctly, but I hear no music. So if we advance that a little bit more, we have to ask, how does the artist get to that point as a visual painter? This is a painter by Dennis Miller Bunker. It's a small piece. I would think that the chances of it that he did it right on location, plein air, are pretty good. I don't find it necessarily all that exciting or what I call it successful. It's definitely not a masterpiece. But Bunker was the same, he's the same artist that did this beautiful portrait that hangs at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston titled Jessica. He's also the same artist that did this of the field at Medfield, the brook at Medfield. So we go back to his painting of Cool Springs Harbor that he did in 1880. Now, I never had that, I have no idea what Bunker had intended when he painted this, but I do know that he liked the subject well enough that he went back to it a second time, and he came up with this painting, which to me is far more exciting. And what I start to see is it's just painting. So much of painting is a refinement of thought, of asking yourself, what drew me to this subject? Why did I stop here? And I think if we go and look at these two paintings, that we start to understand a little bit about what drew Bunker to this scene. It's not, and then you start to eliminate things. You start to ask yourself questions. Do I need the sunny sky? Do we need a blue sky to show that it's sunlight? I can show that this painting has, I think it has very exciting sunlight because of the high contrast, the light hitting the top of that wall. And this is obviously a harbor scene somewhere in New England. And the lobstermen in New England aren't much different than the ranchers in the West in the sense that, God forbid you ever throw anything out, you might need that string of baling twine 15 years from now. I might need that net out of that lobster pot, you know, or my children might need it. So we start to look at what he's eliminated. Do I have to show, you know, are the trees important to the subject? Sky. I want to focus in back to that. So to me, I find the second painting, the more refined painting, much more exciting. How do we do that as painters, as artists? I usually start with value, just black and white shapes. This is a painter of a friend of mine, Ron Kingswood. If you have a high key painting or a lighter painting, your eye will automatically go to the darker elements in it. Known fact. As it goes here, the first thing we see are the abstract placement of the rocks, and then you see the crow at the top. And then after a while, you might see the crow on the left-hand side. Right, but left-hand side, I believe. Ron's paintings are usually all large in size. It's not quite that large, but they're big. And they're beautifully composed, in my opinion. So here's a painting by the great English painter William Nicholson. Again, a high key painting. Most of this painting is on the lighter side of the value spectrum. And what I love about this painting is he's taken and he ties that knife right into the shadow of the plate, and then to the reflection of the cast shadow of the spoon up on the top. And it has that wonderful abstract shape. Again, it's representational, but there are abstract elements within the painting. On the other side of that, you take a dark painting or a low-key painting, as this painting by Antonio Mancini called John the Baptist, which is, hangs in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and it's, he's life-size or a little larger than life-size. I'd say this is a 7.5 or an 8-foot canvas. I apologize, I don't know exactly how big it is. But by darkening everything, by simplifying the background, your eye goes to the light hitting John's chest and his knee. And when you look at it, this is almost a relief sculpture. The paint, the thickness of the paint on his knee, you could measure with a ruler. I mean, it's such a spectacular painting to see in real life, as is most of Mancini's work. And that when you're looking at pieces in books, or you have to be aware, I always look at what size they are, because if you take a painting this big and you reproduce it down, regardless of the reproductions, it looks much more realistic, representational than it is in real life. So if you can, visit museums and see the originals. Again, another low-key dark painting. This is by William Leach, called The Interior of a Cafe. And I always thought Leach was a turn of the 20th century English painter. And I was teaching a workshop one time, and I had a guy named Vincent Crotty taking the class. And it was his second class workshop that he had taken from me. And I use a lot of visuals when I'm teaching. And Vincent, for the week and a half, the whole first workshop, I don't think he said a word. And I showed this about the second workshop that he is in, and I said, this is John Leach, who is a wonderful English painter, and Vincent was sitting up in the front, and he said, he's an Irishman. And then he went on and never said another word the rest of the week. So I take it from Vincent that William was an Irishman. I think by how beautifully this piece is painted that he probably knew his subject matter quite well. I love, again, the abstraction. If we had the ability to take this slightly out of focus, there would just be these wonderful dark patterns. And again, had the restraint that he shows of how the bright reflection on the wall is so much more intense and higher contrast than any of the reflections on those bottles and the glasses above the bar. So there's restraint. He's not painting exactly what he sees. He's making decisions of where he wants the viewer's eye to be. And those shapes, the negative, look at that wonderful negative shape of the woman in the back room as you're looking through that room. Again, so we can use value, we can use line or angle, we can use color. And a lot of works have both. This, of course, is Maynard Dixon's The Wild Horses of Nevada. And look at the wonderful design of the distant hills and the angle and the abstract pattern. And by abstract, just the shapes, they're almost like notes of music in between the horses and the shadows of the horses. And the angle coming up from the lower right to the upper left hand of that beautiful abstract. Part of the horses are in shadow, part of them are in sunlight. And then you look a little closer and you think, wow, there's a gray horse in front, there are a couple bay horses or roans, and the beautiful pattern of the colors of the horses within that mass. And then you look at a little smaller part of it. To me, that's pure abstraction, even though it's representational. We can do it as Angelo Morbelli did in this piece, which is, I just love this piece. And the strong diagonal angles, the intense little light coming in from the windows, and then the different gestures of the men there at the, I think it's probably the prayer tables in a cathedral. Another thing we can do is we use color. And color, I think, like in music, if you have a symphony going, when you have the violins playing, the bass and the viola and the cellos, they can play, but they have to be downplayed a little bit. If your orchestra is all playing at the top of their instrumental capability, you have no symphony, you have noise. And they're all trying to cancel out each other. This is a piece that Jamie Wyatt did called Berg. It's his island, that's his lighthouse in an island that he owns just off the coast of Maine. I can't remember in my lifetime, this was painted just in 2012, and I think we're going the opposite way, we're losing our eyes. I don't think Maine has ever had. So this is a made up piece out of his head. It came from a dream that he had, he told me. And it was in his last show that was at the Denver Art Museum. When I saw this piece, it just blew me away. It's a work on paper, but Jamie and his watercolors and stuff, and he experiments so much. I mean, that you can see that it's just, he uses gouache and he takes watercolor right out of the tube. And I found this surface, this painting just nearly buckled my knees the first time I saw it. But with color, it's primarily a cool palette in the foreground, and then he's got those beautiful warm of the island, and then the little hot shots of orange and yellow-orange up in the clouds. So again, another piece that's representational. We know what we're looking at, but there's a lot of abstraction within it. And it's a piece by John Felsing, and this is it's fun to see some of these paintings when they're blown up quite big, because John, up until the last couple of years, has painted quite small. This piece, I don't think it's probably much bigger than a 10 by 14 or a 12 by 16. Maria probably knows exactly what the size of it. But again, you have a cool palette. Most of the colors go on the blue or to the violet side. And then you see the importance of the little rosy hint of the warmth in the sky. And Richard Diebenkorn, another one of his, there's a tiny painting, just 12 by 8 inches. But the experimentation of a really warm field with just some little shapes of forms of cooler than the blue on the bottom and the violet running through kind of just off the center of it. And then some really hot reds and pinks. A non-representational piece in the sense that we really don't know what it is, but I don't see much difference between this piece and this piece of Rancho de Taos by Maynard Dixon. If we look back at it, it's warm. About 92% of the painting are warm yellows in a really warm side of the palette, as is Dixon's. This maybe be a little closer, but you have that warm, then you have some abstract shapes of the dark shapes in there, and then you have that bright blue sky. So when I look at a piece like this, I see more abstraction in it than I do just a adobe structure. So all the paintings that I've shown you, it's just my speculation of what I see in the painting. So I thought I'd have one painting that I know what the artist was at least attempting to show you. For the last year or so, I've been working on an exhibition of my hometown that is in small-scale paintings. I don't think anything will be larger than 12 inches. And I was born and raised in Sheridan, Wyoming, but I've been away from it for a number of years. Dory and I and our family have been in the Midcoast, Maine for the last, since, 2001. So when I came back to Sheridan and I was asked to do an exhibition, I wasn't quite sure what I was going to do. We lived in Austin going on 5 years ago, and at the very tail end of my time in Austin, I really started to see urban scenes that had a great pictorial ability and potential. But I was right in the middle of working on another exhibit with Sue Simpson from Simpson Gallery, so I didn't have that opportunity to do any of the urban paintings that I had in my head. So So when we moved back to Sheridan and I was invited to do a show, I thought, okay, I'll do it. This is my chance to paint something completely different for me. I've painted houses and a few structures before, but I've started and I thought, I'm going to paint my hometown with a fresh perspective. So I was out early one morning, and I do a lot of walking, I walk down alleys, I stand, you know, wee hours in the morning looking at people. I'm sure, I haven't had anybody call the cops on me yet, but I'm sure it's probably coming at some point. This particular morning, it was bitter cold, so I was in a car, I was in my vehicle driving, and I saw this, and as I mentioned in the statement, Christmas lights are one of my earliest memory of my childhood. I think when I was almost probably four, we were on our way driving back to West Virginia where my father was from, and we drove down through Denver, and right there at the Capitol in the Mint, they had a road or traffic going, and there were millions of lights on the Capitol building in the Mint, and it's one of my most vivid things. I've always loved Christmas lights. As I got older, you know, I started to think, well, you know, I'm not quite sure what brightly colored Christmas lights have to do with the celebration of the birth of Jesus. And I understand that you're in the depth of winter and at night, but when I saw this, I thought, now, and this is a small house that they're around Sheridan, but I never really understood them. And there used to be two coal mines right on the border of Montana and Wyoming. One was Coy and one was Monarch. And when those mines closed, they didn't tear the houses down. They picked them up and they moved them and they put them in parts of Sheridan. And this is one of those houses. They're almost all 900 square feet. But when I saw this 7.5 or 8 foot snowman outside, I thought, all right, this is beyond me. I don't know where we, I understand the jump from Christmas lights to Christmas, but to the life of me, I still don't understand how we could jump from the birth of Jesus to an 8 foot inflatable snowman. But I was fascinated by the scene, and all of a sudden, the 1981 Talking Heads song popped in my head as I was thinking, this is not my beautiful house. This is not my beautiful wife. How did we get here? And so I came back to I have my notebook, and I have a pretty extensive system of color charts that I use in the field, and made some notes. I went right back to the studio, and I did a little study, thinking that it would be a piece for the exhibition that I'm working on. And then I was so excited by the study and the challenge of trying to do something, I thought, I got to do a big painting for this. So even that morning, I took a canvas that I had, a panel that I had, and I started blocking the painting. After a week or so, and Dory saw it, and there was a little bit to it, she said, you got to put that in Prix de West. And I said, I got to put that in Prix de West. And she said, yeah, no, you really do. It's Western. It's real. So it ended up being in here. But the challenge of doing this piece was, you only have a certain window of your pigment. We're trying, everything about what we do is an illusion to some degree or other, because we're trying to paint the effect of sunlight, which is on a scale of about this big, and we're trying to paint it with a range of pigment that's about this big. So I knew that I couldn't have color anywhere else in the painting, or else I wouldn't have the room to try to get the luminosity of the colored Christmas lights. So I intentionally kept everything gray, either a warmer or grayer, without trying to keep it flat. I decided right away that I wanted the house almost dead center in the canvas. I decided early that I didn't want, there were three cars parked along the front of along the street, and I didn't want to include any of the cars there. I just wanted to concentrate on the house and the lights and the inflatable Frosty and his character sidekick there. I purposely turned the angle of the sidewalk and made the shoveling path have a slight angle, as I wanted to hopefully create a little tension as you went in. I also varied the abstract shapes on the right and left side of the house so that they weren't similar, you know, they weren't the same. There was a little variation there. about the fourth or fifth time I was going back making observations and making notes, the light on the house on the left flipped on. And I thought, oh, that was pretty neat. So I include the bright warm light in the neighbor's house. The other thing that I intentionally did is I wanted to change the shape of the two trees, on the tree masses on the other side. I intentionally wanted to make one a little rounder and hopefully would relate and add a little harmony to the inflatable structure of the snowman. And then the other I wanted to elongate a little bit to subtly and quietly hopefully have a little repetition for Frosty's sidekick there, the inflatable dog that's down to his left. So those are the things that I tried to do in this piece. It's a different subject, but I purposely try to set up challenges for myself that I can do. I'm not quite sure how I'm doing on time, so please let me know if I'm running on too long. Here's another piece. This is by Anton Mauve. It's The Return of the Flock. The other way that I think painters do are they manipulate. We're really nothing but a bunch of liars. We take things that we see and we change things. Now, I've spent a lot of time outside, and even though this isn't an overcast painting, it has this wonderful top light. In all my years of being outside, I've never seen a light source this strong where the ground plane is that dark. But by massing all those sheep together and purposely, another thing is accidents really don't happen. Contrary to Bob Ross, who's far more famous than that ever be, painting is not a lot of just happy accidents. They're conscious decisions. Sometimes they're subconscious decisions, but you're constantly making decisions. So in reality, I think this painting probably looked closer to this. But if he paints the foreground, if he paints the ground plane as light as it is in reality, you lose that impact of that flock of sheep. It gets much more confusing, in my opinion. Again, I have no idea what Anton Mauve was trying to accomplish with this, but this is my feeling. This is so I think he's purposely darkened the ground plane to emphasize that flock of sheep. Not in a pictorial standpoint, but in an abstract standpoint. And this is a drawing that was done by Andrew Wyeth called Far From Needham. Needham, Mass. Is where Andrew's father, N.C. Wyeth, was born in 1882. It's remained a huge part of N.C. Wyeth's life, his entire life. The story within the family is that every evening, or nearly every evening for his entire life, no matter where N.C. was, he would go out as close to sunset as he was setting, and he would turn and face the direction of wherever Needham Wax was and picture himself back in his home with his parents through his entire life. The Wyeth family is extremely close family. N.C., Andrew, Andrew's brothers and sisters, who all painted except for his brother Nat, and his sister Ann, who was a composer. But it's still a very sacred place to him. So by the title itself, Far From Needham, this is up in Maine at somewhere. It's a highly developed drawing, but it's an exploratory drawing in a sense. And again, when Dory and I moved to Maine, I was fortunate enough to have met Mr. Wyeth on several occasions, and I had a couple great conversations with him. I never had the opportunity to talk to him about this piece, but I think you can see from the next piece, also titled Far From Needham, that again, there's a refinement of thought of what is this painting about. Now, I think if we go back, that there's a good chance that this is probably what he was really looking at. And then as he got into his tempera, a very timely. He spent hours, weeks, months developing his egg temper. He realized that the two goats really didn't say much about what his feeling and his emotions toward Needham were. So if they're not adding anything in a painting, if you have an element that's not adding to your painting, it's distracting from it. There's very little area where it's neutral. If it's not there for a purpose, it's a distraction. And I think Mr. Wyeth perhaps felt that, so he takes them out. This is a pine tree, a white pine tree, and they're all over Maine. And when you see them in the field, they're like wonderful ballerinas. There's a gracefulness to it. And Andrew Wyeth painted them as well as anybody I've ever seen. But he took and he figured, well, I can change it. I don't have to paint it exactly as I see it. So to me, this tree is far more dynamic, far more powerful than the one he had in his drawing. If we go back. So again, we can have a piece that's near total abstraction, or is total abstraction. Or we can have a piece like Vermeer's Lady in the Woman in Blue reading letter. It's painted in 1663 to 1664. Has anybody had the chance or heard about a movie called Tim's Vermeer? It was done a few years ago, I think in 2012 or so. A computer technician guy named Tim Jennison became fascinated with Vermeer. There's all kinds of speculation whether Vermeer used optics or not. It started with kind of David Hockney, the great English painter, had a book that came out called Secret Knowledge. My dealer at the time gave me the book, and I thought, what a jerk. You know, Hockney was a big time, and he's one of those artists that skirts the abstraction to representation. But I wouldn't consider Hockney the greatest draftsman. And when I was given the book, I thought, here he is. He's gonna take down the great masters to make his work look better. Boy, was I wrong. I read that book and I was fascinated by it. He gives a really compelling evidence, like clinical, scientific evidence, that the great masters probably, and there's no written record so we don't know, but the way he presents it, in my mind, there's no question they used optics. And why wouldn't they? Artists are creative people. They're curious people by nature. And the optics were just coming in to Holland in the early 17th century. But we have this piece of Vermeer. And I think in the movie, Tim makes a very good point. The guy that directed it, and Penn and Teller, is part of their movie, they were involved in it. I had the opportunity when we were in Austin to meet Tim Jennison. And I went to the place that he created. He took a warehouse and he built a Vermeer's room. By the proportions of the canvas, they can tell you in the size of the room, and with his computer capability, he rebuilt the entire room. It had a harpsichord there. And it's a projection through, and he used a mirror, lenses that were, but I had the opportunity to sit down and use this apparatus. And from 45 or 50 feet of the depth of the room, there was a pattern of seahorses that you could barely see. You know, you definitely couldn't see it, or I couldn't see it well enough to paint it. But with this apparatus where it's projected into a mirror, and then you look at a mirror at an angle onto the flat surface, I could draw it perfectly. And Tim is trying to make a point in his movie. And like most people who are trying to make a specific point, you only give one side of it. And I think he does a pretty compelling job that there's little question that Vermeer used some kind of optics. What he fails to realize that, in my opinion, even though he's using optics, he's making artistic decisions. And I'll show you why. This is an Officer and the Laughing Woman that was painted 6 years earlier in 1658. But notice the map on the back of the wall. This map was full color. And then look at the map in the Vermeer painting, done 6 years later. It's the exact same map. One's in full color, one's in muted. Now Holland and the Netherlands, in 1579, the seven countries of the Netherlands, called the Lowlands, split from the Catholic Spanish dominance. And they formed a thing, they formed it called the Protestant Union of Utrecht. Ever wonder where Utrecht's art supplies or why that name's used? Just dawned on me why. But freed from the Catholic, the dominance of the Catholic censorship, Holland became, and the Netherlands became, a mecca for publishers. They could come, they wanted to print pamphlets, they wanted to do maps. But map making in the early 1700s was still a very laborious job. The cartographers had to do everything by hand. Kinko's was not invented yet. It wasn't founded until 1970, some 312 years later. So you can't tell me that they just happen to have two maps exactly the same. So even though Vermeer, if he was using optics, he's making artistic decisions. If we go back to the original, look how beautifully harmonized this is. That heavy blue dress. Those chairs could be any color, but they're beautiful blue. And again, we see how the map that was full color in the officer, laughing officer and woman, is now muted to the perfect harmony. Now, if we look at the angle of the light coming in, we see the shadow against the wall. So there's a good chance that the figure is casting a shadow somewhere also. And it might not be right there, but it's going to say it might be a little lower. But there's almost an absolute chance that there's a shadow somewhere on that wall that Vermeer has decided to leave out because of that beautiful abstract shape on the backside of that woman. With that intensity of the light coming in, there's also probably a good chance that it might be hitting a few of the objects on the top of the table. And I just, you know, these are just theories of mine, and I went in and Photoshop and made some adjustments. So it might not have looked anything like that. But it could have looked like that, and he's making artistic decisions that he's going to simplify to create more of the drama. If we look at the little negative shapes on the lower right-hand corner of those negative spaces, and don't think of that as a chair, just think of that as a dark shape with those four lighter than abstract shapes, and think how, look how interesting those are. There's not one of them that are close to the same shape. So to me, it doesn't matter if Vermeer is using optics at all. It's what he brings to it. That's the magic of Vermeer. There have been hundreds of people, thousands of people that use optics that can't produce anything nearly as close to this. So I think the fact that if you believe that he used optics, that it just makes Vermeer's genius even greater. Again, some of that early definition of abstract not being removed from nature. This is Clifford Still in the 1946 painting called Indian Red and Black. Now, I don't know if this has any reference to nature or not, but when I saw it, it reminded me of a Japanese stewardia and the exfoliating bark. It's just a photograph that I pilfered off the website. But we were given, my son and I were given a small tree of this that we have growing in Maine, and when you see a mature Japanese stewardia there, they have one of the most interesting, beautiful patterns in their bark. And I see a great deal of resemblance to Clifford Still's piece. Now, I have no idea where he got his inspiration, but when I saw that, again, it reminded me of the Japanese stewardia. I don't do much figurative work in my work, but I love trees, and I've been fascinated by trees. So several years ago, I attempted to do a painting of tree bark. I heat my studio in Maine with a fireplace, and We have a number of acres of just hardwoods and woods, and so I cut my firewood, and as it dries, a lot of times the bark would come off. And I was so fascinated with the patterns of the bark that I got some long drywall screws, and I just started, because of the cup of the bark, I just screwed them to my wall above my library, and I had a virtual forest right inside my little library. And they sat there for 3 or 4 years, and then one day I thought, I've spent hours and hours, hundreds of hours looking at this, I'm going to try to paint one, just for a challenge. And I started, the only thing I knew going in is I'm going to do anything I can think of to try to paint this as realistically as I possibly can. So I got really excited. I went out and I spent a day or two walking around our woods looking for a tree that I thought had some interesting pattern on it. Got my chainsaw, cut the tree down. Cut the tree in half, and I thought, I wanted to paint this as big as I could. And if I look back on Clifford Still's work, it's 78 by 63 inches. I would have loved to do a painting that big on the Bark series. I didn't have the physical strength, nor the mental strength, nor the creativity to find out a way to do that. So I cut the tree in half, and I couldn't even roll it. I got my tractor out, and I could roll it, but I couldn't pick it up. So I cut that in half, and I got down to about a 4-foot section that I could get close to my studio, but I couldn't get it inside. And I wanted to paint it directly from life. I didn't want to use any photographic reference, and I set it up just like sight size, like you would a portrait. I was doing a portrait of a piece of bark. So I cut it down to where I could muscle it in and put it on my table. And in hindsight, I wish I had figured out some way to get a crane or a chain or be creative enough where I could have at least done it double size, where it was, 5 or 6 feet tall. I let the width determine what the width of the tree was. So I did my panel just like that. And I tried anything I could to try to get the texture of it. I would put wet paint down, and I'd take a soft, fine charcoal, and I'd draw into it, let that set up, and dust the charcoal off. I was using hard lead pencils into wet paint and scribing some of the marks. The interesting thing is, the more realistic I tried to paint it, the more abstract it became. And the English painter Lucian Freud has a quote that says, the longer you look at an object, the more abstract it becomes, and ironically, the more real. And that was definitely the case with this. So if we go back to the difference of abstraction, representation, sometimes you don't know. Sometimes if we take a piece that's total abstraction, we flip it around, we back up a little bit more, and then step back, all of a sudden what we thought we were looking at is something completely different. This is a piece again done by Antonio Lopez Garcia. Many people call him, he's been referred to as the greatest living realist alive today. When I went over to see him, I had an opportunity. I don't speak a word of Spanish other than cerveza. And he doesn't speak a word of English. But I had a wonderful translator with us who was the director of the Baron Thiessen Museum. He spoke perfect English and Spanish. Because a lot of times in your translation, particularly in art terms, you lose the subtleties of it. So I had a chance to ask him a couple questions while we were sitting having tea in his studio. And I said, I know, Mr. Garcia, that you're considered the greatest living realist today, but I see a lot of abstraction in your work. I'm curious, is that intentional? Is it just part of the working process? And are you aware of that? And in anywhere in translation, you have that uncomfortable time of the translation. And then he came back, and he's only about this tall. And he had the brightest blue eyes I've ever seen on anybody. And they didn't seem connected in his head. They danced around like there was no retina connected on him. And he said, forgetting, he was extremely modest, and he didn't want any part of being referred to as the greatest realist or anything. And then Guillermo was translating, said, but, and when he started to speak, when Guillermo started to speak in English, Mr. Garcia Lopez's eyes just came alive even more, and he just got this wonderful smile on his face, and he said, the abstraction is what makes it real. And I thought, wow, that is right up my alley. And so I think I'll end with that. If I haven't gone on too long, I set a timer on my phone when I came up, but of course I went to sleep, so I have no idea how long I've talked. But do we have time for questions? Or if anybody has any questions? Is anybody awake? I can't, with these lights out here, I haven't heard a word, so I don't know Do we have time for questions? Somebody said they had a question. Go ahead, yes, sir. Absolutely. I would agree with that completely. One of the things I think as representational painters happens is, I know it happens to me a lot, we get kind of hamstrung by our subject matter, and we don't experiment enough. I mean, if we think of, in landscape, if you think of that tree, whether consciously or subconsciously, you know that tree has a root ball that's about this big and it weighs about 4 tons. And if you're aware of that and you're looking at it as a tree, it makes it really difficult to shift that. But if you think of it as just an abstract shape, it's just a darker or lighter rectangle, and it has nothing to do with the sense that it's a tree, you can put that anywhere on your canvas. You can turn it sideways if you want. But at least for me, in the back of my mind, if I'm thinking of it as a tree, as I'm painting it, it gets really difficult to move it. What I admire about the abstract expressionist is, and you look through a body of their work, they spend a great deal of time experimenting. You look through Richard Diebenkorn's work of his, what he called his Ocean Park series. He has hundreds and hundreds of experimentations of abstract shapes around the edge of the thing. Joseph Albers did over 1,000 panels of what he called an homage to a square. And they're all similar in that they have a square in them, but they're all vastly different because he's changing mathematical proportions and color schemes. As representational painters, I think we would all advance our work more if we gave ourselves the freedom to experiment more, both in the subjects that we're painting, but also in the materials we're using. And I've started purposely for the last 5 or 6 years, I have at least one thing in the studio going that is just total experimentation. Sometimes, like the Bark series, I had so much fun painting that first one that I showed you, I did 4 others. And I felt extremely fortunate that the Tia collection in Santa Fe bought them, that Sue Simpson was able to put a deal together. But I don't go into them thinking that they're going to be anything other than experimentation. And a lot of times, I'm incapable. I'm a junkie. I cannot walk into an art supply store without buying something. And I usually try to buy something that I'm not familiar with. And the English pencil maker Derwent came out. I've known about it for about 4, maybe 5 years. They could have been around for 30 years, I don't know, but they came out with some new graphite called Graphitin, and it's still graphite, but it has these wonderful subtle shades of cool grays, warm grays, and some earth tones. And so I've started to experiment with pencil drawings, and you have a little bit of colors. They're not colorful, but there's just enough range of temperature that it gives this wonderful dimension that they're still pencils. But when you look at a Diebenkorn, he's using acrylic paint and pastels and pencil and watercolor and anything they can think of, cottage cheese for, I don't know. But, and they, you know, now we're 50, 60, 70 years later, and they're still holding up from an archival standpoint fairly well. So I'd encourage everybody. And the other thing about it is when we're working on our main things, it's a real struggle, at least it is for me. I mean, you just feel like you're beating your head against a cement wall for a while. And so when you, if you have that experimentative element in your quiver, it makes things a lot more fun. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Very good question. Could everybody hear that question? You asked, how was I able to transpose or translate the colors, whether I used photography from the scene with the house called Letting the Days Go By, into the studio. That piece was done completely in the studio. I spent, the first 15 years of my career painting outside plein air. I didn't have a studio. And I felt I got to a position where I could put together a pretty decent field study. But when I started to go to the museums and really advance my studies and really look at the masterpieces, the Rembrandts, the Vermeers, the Raphaels, the Goyas, there was a huge disconnect from what I was doing to what I was looking at. And I realized that a lot of the great works that hang in the museums that we refer to as masterpieces, we're not painted outside for in a three-hour window. I love plein air. There's nothing that substitutes painting from life, but it's part of the process. It's not the end. It's not the end of it. So I have developed, and I know George Carlson has a similar. And I've developed a series of color charts. I have one for every color on that I have permanently on my palette or that stays my main colors. And it's based on a two-color mixture. So I have the color that I am and then the color that's next to it on my palette. And then you tint it out with white. And the reason you don't add a third or a fourth color, because back in the studio, because it only has two colors, I can get back to that exact proportion. And then that's a jumping off spot. It's never the exact color. And even if you have the exact color, once you put the color next to it, that relationship is what's the important part. So the color that you thought was perfect, if you put the color next to it, it changes. But I have these, and I have a pneumatical system, or numerical system that I can use, that I use in reference. I do use photographs. I'll use photographs for reference. I get to a point in the painting that I start to fight with the photographs. Because as long as I've done this and I know that I can't paint what's in the photograph, at some point I'll stand and, you know, I'll be painting away for a week or so and I'm struggling and I look back and I think, well, you've got that telephone pole right where it is in the photograph when it shouldn't be in your painting at all. So I found that works best for me is at the end of the painting when I'm trying to finish it. And I'm a pretty slow, methodical, but I work, I build the layers up. So, you know, I'll work on some of these paintings for 4 or 5 months. And I have a couple of them going at the same time where I'm not working on one continuously for that time. But I like to let them dry, and sometimes I sand them, and sometimes I'll add other elements. So I'm not working on it totally, but I work on them over a period of time. But as I get toward the end of the painting, I try to put all my reference away. Forget the photographs. And I bring out my original thumbnail, or my first drawing that I have to write something down when the inspiration hits me, and that's what I bring out, and I'm most successful if I can only rely on that, because a lot of it is the inspiration for me, and I think it's probably similar for most of the painters here. It kind of hits you like a thunderbolt, and then a lot of it is shedding the distractions of reality of life. Family commitments, obligations, news, and to try to get back, I feel like a lot of times a salmon swimming upstream to get back to the spawning ground. You try to get back, the whole process is some degree or another, is trying to get back to that core inspiration, that pure inspiration. And I'm arrogant enough to say that the images, the paintings I have in my head are beautiful. What comes out on the canvas, there's a disconnect there. So, and I think most of the artists feel that to some degree. And I look at other paintings, paintings in this exhibition, and they're fresh to me. I can't see their original, their original inspiration. I just get to see the thing. I look at mine, and all I see is my shortcomings. I just see where I fell short from the inspirational piece that I saw. So does that help answer your question at all? But I'll use any reference, I'll use anything that I can think of that will help me try to achieve to get closer to that inspiration. Any other questions, Tucker? Thank you very much. Again, I'll just make one final comment. I want to thank everybody for coming. I want to encourage all of you to go through this exhibition now and not get bogged down by the subject matter. Walk up close to the painting and look at it from a couple inches away, and then go back and look at it from the edge of the room. And if you like what you see, buy. Buy, because that's the greatest way you can support us. And there's nothing like it. If you get a good painting, it will be a friend of yours for life. There is no such thing as an old painting. And the great ones are new every time you look at them. And if you get a great painting, you can own it for 20 or 30, 40 years. And the really good ones, you'll see something in it brand new every day. I was talking to my friend George Carlson, and we all admire an artist named Emil Carlson. And George said, I have one that hangs right outside my bedroom window, and I walk by it every day. And I can't remember how long he owned it, but it's I think George bought it when he's a young man, and George is only a middle-aged man now. But he just told me within the last 3 or 4 weeks that I see new things in it every time I look at it, even after all those years. And that's really exciting. So I hope you'll go through, look at the paintings in this exhibition, look at it from a slightly different attitude, viewpoint, not get bogged down by the subject matter, and try to look at the abstraction in it. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Tim. In just a moment, we will break for lunch. Located at the museum's main entrance and remaining open until 4 o'clock, we encourage you to visit the museum store trunk show. Several Prida West artists are available again today for a book signing beginning here in the SEC. We invite our premium package holders, society members, event sponsors, and artists to please stay and join us today for lunch. All other patrons can exit the room and enjoy lunch at the museum grill just outside this room. And please join us back here at noon for the awards announcement. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Prida West Committee Chair, Greg Simon.
Good afternoon to you all. Welcome to the highly anticipated Prida West Awards announcements. On behalf of the museum's board of directors, we are honored to have you with us at the nation's premier Western art exhibition. Now, please welcome our incoming Pre-to-West Committee Chairman, Dan Carazzi. Dan? Okay, a little out of the ordinary, but one of our Pre-to-West artists is getting ready to celebrate his 80th birthday next week. Will you please all join me in singing Happy Birthday to Joe Bowler? Happy
to... Oh, come on, let's start.
Okay, hold it. No way.
1, 2, 3.
Happy birthday.
I guess I'll never make it as a singer. Thanks. Good afternoon, everyone. Last evening, we had the pleasure of honoring and recognizing six of our very talented Pre-to-West artists for their work in this year's exhibition. And at this time, I would like to again have us recognize them while we enjoy looking at their winning creations. I would ask you to please hold your applause until the work of all six award winners has been displayed. As your name is called for the artist, we would ask you to please stand and remain standing for the entire time until the end of all of the images have been displayed. First one is the Donald Teague Memorial Award for Exceptional Artistic Merit for a Work on Paper, and that was awarded to Bruce Green for Cowboy Cadillacs. The next one was the Express Ranch's Great American Cowboy Award, presented to Bill Anton for Who's Got the Cards. The James Earl Fraser Sculpture Award, presented to Walter Matthay for Two for the Road. And again, Walter is home recuperating. The Major General and Mrs. Don D. Pittman Wildlife Award, presented to Greg Beecham for Feathers and Dust. And the Frederick Remington Painting Award, presented to George Carlson for Winter in Monochrome. And the Wilson Hurley Memorial Award for an Outstanding Landscape was presented to Brent Cotton for Under the Tall Cottonwoods. On behalf of the Pre-to-West Committee, I extend my sincerest personal congratulations to these 2018 award winners for their outstanding works. For the rest of the afternoon, as you're walking around, please be sure to look for these award-winning pieces when you are visiting the galleries and during this evening sale. And please don't be shy about putting your name in the boxes for these award-winning pieces and for all of the other marvelous works of art that we have in this fabulous show. Thank you. And now, I also have the distinct privilege of announcing the recipient of the Robert Lockheed Memorial Award. This award is sponsored by Barbara and Roger Simons in memory of Phaedra and George Simons, true Western enthusiasts. The award was established in 1988 in memory of the late Robert Lockheed, a Pre-to-West artist who influenced many other artists with his talent and his teachings by mentoring such Pre-to-West artists as Wayne Wolfe, Randall Dutra, and John and Terry Moyers. A $3,000 award goes to the recipient of this award, and each year that recipient of the award is chosen by his or her fellow exhibiting Pre-to-West artists who select their favorite display of three or more works by their peers. And at this time, it is my distinct pleasure to announce and invite to the stage the recipient of the 2000 Robert Lockheed Memorial Award for his works entitled An Early Bloomer, Time Exposure, Jalama Court, Estuary, California Coast, and that recipient is Len Shamil. Lynn's walking very slowly up here, trying to think what he's going to say when he gets up here.
This is a bit of a shock. I happen to be sitting right across from Chris Blossom when he heard the announcement that he had just won the Prix de West Award. And I could see every molar in the bottom of his jaw. The folks at my table now know that I still have my tonsils. This is really quite something and very, very special to me to be, to receive an award from your peers. Especially with the creativity that the folks here show over the years and all these many years that I've been fortunate enough to be on the show is really very touching for me. Thank you very, very, very much. So.
Well, congratulations, Lynn. You've now seen the remarkable works in the Prix de West show, and I trust you'll all agree the caliber of work exceeds all expectations. Each year, the Prix de West committee is faced with a difficult task to select one piece of art for the museum's permanent collection out of the nearly 300 works submitted for this exhibition. As you can imagine, there is a tremendous amount of work that goes into the screening of the art for this event. It's a year-long process, and much consideration is given to one piece that is selected to become the museum's, to be part of the museum's permanent collection. One of these considerations in particular, and unique to the Prix de West in the Purchase Award, is that assuming that the caliber and the quality of more than one work is equivalent, the committee is influenced by the fact that the chosen work be art that will be added to the permanent collection and support the mission of the museum in telling the museum's story of the West. The Prix de West Award is sponsored by Roberta M. Eldridge Miller. I always do that every year. And the artist receives the purchase price and $5,000 award. This award is the most coveted by participating artists because the museum will acquire the Prix de West Purchase Award winner and has done so every year since 1973. In fact, they're on display at the gallery just behind the Lincoln statue, just to your right as you exit from here. The resulting Prix de West collection is rich in diversity and style, subject matter and medium, containing works by many of the most celebrated artists over the last 50 years. The collection forms the cornerstone of the museum's world-renowned Western art holdings. Before we name this year's winner, Let's turn our attention to the screens as we recognize the previous winners. We now invite all past Pre-to-West Purchase Award winners who are with us to please stand and get recognized by all of us, please. The selection of the Purchase Award each year is extremely significant because the work, as I've said, becomes part of the museum's story for generations to come. By visiting the galleries, you can look back through the years and see each work that was most influential in its time to the museum's history in its place in time. Tonight, you will see our generosity jars located near the winning piece, but to donate now, the generosity jars are located at the back, right behind me, or right in front of me, I should say. If you'd like to help underwrite the Purchase Award, please simply slide your credit card in there and click some plastic, okay? We know you know how to do that. With that being said, the Pre-to-West Committee selected a single piece to the best complement the collection and undoubtedly be appreciated for many years to come. I am pleased to announce that this year's, the 2018 Pre-to-West Purchase Award winner for his piece entitled Blasting a Route Through the Sierra Nevada Mountains, Mion Sittu.
That really is an unexpected surprise. Come to this show with so many great works I love, and with so many great artists I admire. I never expect I can have this award, so that is so surprise. And I'd like to thank the museum, the committee of the Pretty West Show, and for inviting me to such a great family. I also like to thank my wife, Glory, for her supporting. Thank you very much.
Almost walked out without introducing our next speaker, one of our rising up-and-coming curators, Eric Singleton. Please come up, Eric.
Congratulations to our award recipients, and thank you to everyone who attended today's seminars. Now, this room is going to be closing to prepare for tonight's live auction and closing celebration, but we invite you to spend the afternoon in our galleries. Beginning at 1 o'clock, you can enjoy more 10-minute spotlight talks. We invite you to our artist demonstrations in the East Hallway from 1 to 2:30. Come to admire the talents of Joseph Bowler, Russell Case, Bruce Green, and Sandy Scott. We hope you will join us for the sale beginning tonight at 5:30. Enjoy your visit through the galleries and have a wonderful afternoon. Thank you very much.